And it hits me, oh my gosh, this is that triangle.
You know, there's explanation for everything that occurred in the Rendlesham Forest incident that doesn't involve aliens at all.
It was completely silent. It comes right over our heads.
He saw a classic flying saucer, really, standing in the clearing.
He turned over to my father and held his hand, and he looked in his eyes and he said, "We're not alone."
Hello and welcome to the show. I'm actually broadcasting from Russia. You regular listeners know this. I gave some warning. So today's actually Tuesday, too. So we're a day early and we're not a dollar short, but we are in the afternoon, Eastern Standard Time, 1 to 3 p.m., which is actually 8 to 10 p.m. My time here. I'm at Moscow time if you want to check it out. I'm at the Black Sea. It's a beautiful area. And having a good time. I'm here for 42 days in total. So I'll be running my shows on Wednesday afternoon from 1 to 3 p.m. That's when you can catch me live on YouTube. And I have gotten some email from the people in Europe, and they're real excited about it because they can actually watch it live. Thank you if you are listening live. And the chat room's available as well, and I'll be checking messages on that throughout the show. So thanks so much, and we are ready to get started. Alejandro couldn't make it today. He'll be back next week. He's going to be joining us live. It's just because I had to do it the day early that he could not make it. Now, we have the one and only Kevin Randle. I'm real excited to have him. He and I are going to be talking about a document now noted on the webpage, Midnight in the Desert, that we have to announce. This was something that was released to Heather Wade on Midnight in the Desert, and we're going to be talking about that. It's been making a lot of buzz, and Kevin had a top-secret security clearance. He knows how these documents are supposed to be written and has a lot of great information on it. And Kevin, welcome to the show. How are you doing?
I'm doing fine, and you're in Russia.
I'm in Russia, and I just what did you say I did? I compromised your security clearance.
I was about to say that you just compromised me. The NSA now is seeing that I'm getting phone calls or Skype messages from the former Soviet Union, now Russia. So I'm probably dead in the water here. Thanks a lot, fella.
Sorry about that. But I'm so glad to have you on. And I have said this many times before on my show, and actually when I do Alejandro Rojas's news on Open Minds .tv, as well as you are the go-to guy, I think, in a lot of cases when it comes to getting the true story on what's going on. And I was really happy to see that you explored this document that has been going, I want to say, semi-viral in the UFO community. So so let's talk about it. When's the first time you heard about it and all that?
I heard about it at 4:10 p.m. Central Daylight Time on Wednesday, June 14th. How's that for pinning it down? I was going to have Steve Bassett on my show, A Different Perspective, which is hosted on the X-Zone Broadcast Network. And I couldn't make contact with him, and so we had to fall to our or drop back to our fallback position, which is put up one of the other shows. And he called me at 4:10 and said, "Is this too late?" And I said, "Yeah, the ship has sailed, pal." And he said, "Well, we've been chasing this document." And he told me about it and where it was. And he wanted to get on the radio right then and there and talk about it. And I'm thinking, I haven't even seen it yet. I don't want to have anything to do with it because it's MJ-12. And I'm pretty well convinced that MJ-12 is a hoax. All of it is a hoax. There's really nothing to it of any value. But I wanted to see the document because it could be that I was wrong on that. So, yeah, I mean, you have to see it. So he told me where it was. I downloaded it immediately from Heather's site, Midnight in the Desert, and looked at it. And the first thing I saw, it says, "Ultra Top Secret." And I'm thinking, you know, that just doesn't make good sense to me, Ultra Top Secret, because Ultra was a program for the British during the Second World War where they were talking about or attempting to intercept and decode top secret Nazi communications for the war effort. But it also says at the bottom of the thing, read and destroy. And I'm thinking, well, if it says read and destroy, which is a really dumb instruction, but how did this one escape from that? When you destroy classified materials, and especially secret and top secret materials, you are required to fill out documentation to verify it has been properly destroyed. And so if this was a read and destroy, he would have had to, I probably should say he or she, but it's probably a guy, would have had to document its destruction. So he lied on a government document about its destruction and then spirited it out of the facility. Top secret material requires storage in a vault, by the way, not just a safe or a reinforced filing cabinet. It requires a vault. Wow. So taking a document out like that is something even worse than stealing a secret or a confidential document. So this was the first thing that struck me, but I went on and I looked at it. I looked at the way it was constructed, and the thing that the other thing is, on classified material, there's always a stamp at the top and the bottom that gives a classification, top secret or secret or confidential. It's at the top and the bottom of all pages. This thing only had the classification at the top page. So that's a problem. It said the authors, and there was a big thing across it that said classified. The authors weren't listed. And I'm thinking, I can't think of a reason that you'd have a document created and you can't list who the authors were, because, of course, if they'd listed the names, we'd have been able to maybe find out who they were and what they were doing, or would be unable to find them in a position where they would be creating a document like this. And then I got to the Roswell stuff, and it just really fell apart from there. I think the date says something like 07 July 47, which – 07 July, 1947, which is the way the things are dated on the MJ-12 documents, but that's not standard military dating format. The information inside the Roswell part of this document was just horribly inaccurate. It said, for example, that Jack Brazel had called the sheriff's office at 5 o'clock in the morning. Well, A, Mac Brazel didn't have a telephone, and B, we know from testimony of a number of people that he took the stuff to Roswell. And he got there it early enough that he could interrupt Jesse Marcel's lunch. Jesse Marcel was eating lunch over at the officers' club, according to what Jesse Marcel said when he got the call from the sheriff. So the timing didn't work out. There's all kinds of things like that in the Roswell part of it. They just didn't make any sense. We move on to the Aztec part of it, and it doesn't really fit with the information we know about that. I believe Aztec is a hoax. I don't believe there was anything there. I know that I am in disagreement with a lot of different people on that, but I think the Aztec crash is a hoax as well. So if this is included in the MJ-12 document, in this MJ-12 document, well, that tells me that it's a hoax. But then we get to the part where there's an interview with an extraterrestrial biological entity. And so I read through that. It said it was an interview conducted by several interviewers, lasts a few pages. But the thing that leaped out at me was they said, well, why do you come here? And part of the answer was, well, we like your trees.
Right, yeah.
And I'm thinking, yeah, do you like the Tibetan music and the strawberry ice cream as well? You know, the responses by this alien being were awfully colloquial English. And I can't think that they would be talking in the vernacular of the English, even no matter how smart they were. So there were a lot of little things like that. And that was my first gut reaction to it. But then I went through and looked through it carefully, and it became even worse. The mistakes were just legion. The text didn't make any sense the way it was written. It wasn't written in the way a document like this would be written at the high levels it was. It's riddled with errors and inconsistencies. So my conclusion was, after having an opportunity to read it carefully, and I communicated this to Steve Bassett as well on Wednesday, I think, when we first talked about it. And then we talked about it again on Saturday for my show. But I told him that I thought the thing was a hoax. And I approach these things because I know people are going to say, well, you don't believe MJ-12, therefore anything says MJ-12 you're going to reject out of hand. And I'm always of the mind of the prospector, which is, you always have to look. You don't expect to find gold in certain places, but mm-hmm. you have to look, because in case it's there, you want to be able to find it. And so every time something like this surfaces, I look. to see if it is something that is legitimate. And this thing suffers from all the problems with the other MJ-12 documents, which begins with a lack of provenance. We don't know who the guy was who stole it. We don't know how it got into Heather Wade's hands, although we do know that, according to her, she knows the guys personally who sent it to her, and she finds them reliable, which is completely possible, I suppose. But the document is just outrageously fraudulent. I don't know how else to say it.
Well, let me ask you a couple of questions about it. First of all, have you ever heard of a situation where a document does say read and destroy? Is that a possibility that the government would have ever been involved in a document like that?
I think there are – I always thought the eyes only classification, Secretary of Defense eyes only kind of took care of that sort of circumstance. There possibly could be materials at the highest level of classification that tell people to read it and then destroy it immediately, so it cannot get out into the public.
Yeah.
But in that case, we wouldn't have any of these sort of things to look at.
That's right.
I've never come across anything like that. Which is not to say it doesn't exist. It's just in my career, I never saw anything like that. And to be perfectly candid, for the most part in my career, I only handled secret material. I rarely came across top secret material in my positions, I was one of the few people in the organization. And by that, I mean when I was in the Air Force, either the wing or the group level activity. And when I was in the Army at the battalion level, I rarely came across top secret materials. The nature of my jobs didn't require me to have top secret materials. I did, in fact, attend a defense intelligence school where you had to have a top secret clearance to go because they were dealing with top secret materials and we were getting top secret briefings. And I know of a circumstance of a military museum, and I won't say where, there was a secret room, a top secret room, where you had to have a top secret clearance to get in to see the stuff because of what it was and what it would suggest. And I did get a chance to get into that room. And the interesting side part was the curator took me out into a display area where they had a lot of different military equipment displayed. And one of them had been shot up, and he wanted to know the caliber of the bullets that had gone through there. And I'm thinking, why don't you know this? But it looked to me like it had been hit by 50 caliber rounds. So I said, that's what I said to him. I think it looks like a 50 cal to me. I don't know why they didn't have somebody else that could have told them that. So, or maybe they were just getting a survey of opinion on something like that. But the point is, when we look at this stuff and you start dealing with stuff at the very highest levels, the people who are allowed to see it is very, very limited. Mm-hmm. You have to have a top secret clearance. Second of all, you have to have a need to know. And third of all, there's often a code word that goes with it, and you have to be code word cleared to see it as well. And to use the example from this, it should have said top secret ultra as opposed to ultra top secret. But to see the document then, you would have had a top secret ultra clearance, and that would have been noted. And if you didn't have the top secret ultra clearance, you wouldn't be allowed to see the document, even though you have a top secret clearance. One of the other things that's been mentioned about this is the paragraphs aren't noted. In a lot of the especially the top secret materials, each paragraph will begin with a little parenthetical statement. It'll say like TS for top secret or S for secret, C for confidential, to allow the reader to know the level of classification of that specific material, especially if the material is made up of all different levels of classification. The document will be classified at the highest level of any of the information in it, but all the information doesn't have to be top secret. There's also something else called no foreign. So it means no foreign dissemination. And so you'd see TS-no FORN, no foreign. Uh-huh. And this doesn't have anything like that on it at all. None of those sorts of things are there. And I would expect to see some of that in a document like this.
Sure. Now, a couple of things about this particular document. First of all, is it supposed to have the appearance of being mimeographed or something? What is it? It's very hard to read. And by the way, any listener can read this. It's on, of course, Midnight in the Desert, but it's also on our website linked under the show notes. Do you think it's a mimeograph?
I'll interrupt to say, and you can go to my blog, www.kevinrandle.blogspot.com, and click on the link, and it'll take you to Midnight in the Desert, so you can read the documents that way, too.
Yes.
That was just a plug for my blog, you know.
Don't worry,
If I'm going to do these things, I'm going to plug my blog, dog on it.
Yes, and as I said earlier, I truly believe if you want to find out if a story about UFOs is real or not, and you want to get a really good perspective on it, please do go to Kevin's website, because that's where I always end up landing when I'm looking into something. And there's some really, really great information. I'll do that plug for you, Kevin.
Thank you.
I really, really think your website is very important in this field. So, first of all, what's your thoughts about the mimeograph look?
I don't think it's mimeographed, and it shouldn't be mimeographed, because it's a top-secret document, so the printing of it would be restricted. It doesn't look to me like it's mimeographed. It clearly has been Xeroxed like 9,000 times.
And do you think that was done on purpose to make it look, I don't know, more authentic in some type of way?
I think it was done so that they could cut and paste stuff together.
I see.
And I think that's the purpose of it. I cannot see a document, and I'm looking at the second page of it, and it says authors, and it's stamped classified. I cannot see them doing anything like that. If the authors were classified, the names would have been left out. They wouldn't have put them in there. There's no reason for the names not to be there. I mean, we've got a top secret document. It's given us all the information, and we don't get to know who the authors of the document are. That's preposterous, absolutely preposterous. That's the first clue right there. And then, as I said, you look at the classifications. There's a sheet here, and it's basically blank that's classified. It doesn't really work that way. It should say this page left intentionally blank, which I always laugh about, because if you've written on it, this page left intentionally blank. It's not, in fact, blank. It's got writing on it. But it's included in the document. And what's interesting is the top secret at the top of this page is reversed. It's a mirror image. And I wondered about that, because the rest of it seems to be written properly. So, there's a lot of little dumb things like that. The dating format is wrong for the military. And the other thing is, I don't know why it would be ultra top secret as opposed to top secret MJ-12 or whatever the lousy classification there is using this week. There's places where it says classified where it really shouldn't. I mean, it says classified and this is ultra top secret. Well, that's the classification. I've seen cover sheets that you put on the classified material, and the ones I was most familiar with were sort of a bright pink, and it said classified cover sheet. I've seen others that say top secret cover sheet and secret cover sheet and that sort of thing. I've never seen anything quite like this. So there are just so many little things wrong. When you're a civilian, I guess, someone who has not worked with the military classification or the classified materials, and you're trying to duplicate something like that, there's all kinds of little things that you don't know or you wouldn't notice. A great example is if you watch movies and you see people in military uniforms, you can often realize they don't know the uniforms aren't quite right. The distinctive insignia are placed improperly. Sometimes the ribbons are reversed. Sometimes the ribbons are upside down, meaning the highest ribbon is at the bottom instead of at the top, and that sort of thing. So you look at that, and it's just things civilians don't realize. They've seen pictures of things, and they put it all together. And I think this is what we have here is kind of a conglomeration of stuff. I think the source material for the Aztec stuff especially is William Steinman's book, UFO Crash at Aztec. Mm-hmm. I think that's part of the source material for this. They didn't have Scott Ramsey's book, which is Incident at Aztec, or the Aztec UFO Incident, I'm sorry. And they didn't have Scully's book, which is Behind the Flying Saucers, which are the three books about the Aztec crash. So they obviously had the Steinman book and was working from that.
I do want to talk to you about the Aztec crash later, but one of the things I was thinking about when I opened the document and started reading through it, it said that people named people's names would not be written down. And then further down in the document, it had people's names listed. Was that something I just don't understand, or what were they trying to do with that?
They were trying to cover themselves because they didn't know the names of some of the people who would have been key players. Jesse Marcel's name is out there for everybody to see. Yeah. So you can put his name in there. But other names would be a little bit more obscure. So to cover themselves, they say, well, we've changed some of the names or left them out, which means they just didn't know it. One of the other things, and your question kind of keyed that for me, it said that Twining had gone to Roswell, Lieutenant General Twining had gone to Roswell and relieved Blanchard of his command. And this is something that people outside the military wouldn't understand. Blanchard was not relieved of his command at any point. If he was, we would have documentation, because that's a really big deal. What it should have said was that Twining had gone to Roswell and assumed command because he was the senior officer present for this particular incident. That would have made sense to me, but saying he relieved Blanchard of command, that's not right. He did not relieve Blanchard of command. And I know of a number of circumstances. And going back to my experience in Vietnam, I once was the company commander simply by virtue of being the senior officer on the base. I was a 19-year-old warrant officer.
Oh, wow.
And we had to evacuate a lot of the aircraft. I always like to say I was a senior surviving officer, which is sort of true and sounds really dramatic. But the fact of the matter is we'd evacuated most of the aircraft. And because my aircraft broke, we had been flying all day, and they'd sent out a new bunch of co-pilots. I was the aircraft commander. Sent out a bunch of new co-pilots, and the co-pilot said, should I check the tail rotor? And I said, no, we've been flying all day. And he climbed up there and checked it anyway, and the linkage fell apart in his hands. So we weren't going anywhere. So we were left behind. So I was the senior officer left on the base at the in our company area at the time. So they would come to me with questions for the 12 or 14 hours. I was the company commander. But the point is, I did not relieve anybody of command. I merely assumed command simply because I was the senior officer present.
So it was just that wording was totally off.
Yes. And had Blanchard been relieved, that would have ended his career. If you get relieved for cause from a military unit like that, you're done.
Wow.
You would be out of the service quickly. We've just had an example that we may see something like that, and that was the collision between the container ship and the and the U.S. destroyer.
Yeah,
the captain of that destroyer could be in deep trouble, especially because seven of his sailors were killed. His career might be over at this point, depending on the circumstances.
And I can't even imagine how that whole thing happened with today's technology and equipment. Was he texting?
He was obviously – I believe he was – I don't know where he was. I was going to say he's on the bridge. He and a number of other sailors were injured, and they were medevaced out. I don't know where he was. And even if he was texting, there should have been other people looking at the radar scope, and the guy steering the ship should have been looking around, and there should have been eyes out there to see this container ship, because it's not like it's a little tiny thing that was going to sneak up on you. But I don't understand. But the point is, he will probably find himself relieved, and he'll probably find his career pretty much over. If you have a major mistake like that, you're pretty well screwed. And so if Blanchard had been relieved of his command, as this document says, Blanchard would have been pretty well screwed. And we know that he ended up as a four-star general. He was a vice chairman of Vice Air Force Chief of Staff, four-star general, who died of a heart attack at the Pentagon. So obviously his career was not hurt by this event in Roswell, which suggests, again, that Twining didn't relieve him of his command. And there's really no evidence that Twining actually went to Roswell. He was in New Mexico on some other things, and there's really no evidence that he went to Roswell in any of the documentation. So you can pretty well realize that's another major error. But to answer your question, I think the reason that they said that, you know, some of the names have been changed, or names have been changed, or names have been left out, is simply because they didn't have access to the information, or didn't know where to get the information, and they didn't want to put a name in there that would be proven false, so they just left it out.
Yeah, Kevin, when I my impression, and this is just an armchair person that knows nothing about military. I know nothing about military documents or top secret documents at all, nothing. But my impression when I was reading through it is, why in any circumstance would they jumble all these different incidences together in one document? That's what didn't make sense to me. Is that something that would be done?
If you're trying to provide a complete overview of a situation, you will enumerate all the events. In this document, it talks about Roswell. It talks about Aztec, and it says there's seven others, or I guess five others, seven total. Well, what are the others? Now, if I'm the guy receiving the document, that's my first question. And this documents like this are prepared for commanders and policymakers at the highest level. You need that. You need all that information. And I think once again, they said, "Well, again, that's an attempt to cover themselves by saying, well, there's other events, but we're not going to enumerate them because you know we really don't know." And you can look at that if you look at the whole history of UFO crashes. There are lists out there that incorporate some 300 or 400 different UFO crashes. And I'm thinking, you know, if they're falling out of the sky with that regularity, we'd be having a whole lot of different conversations than we do now. I mean, they're just like falling out of the sky. I had said at one point, when I did crash when UFOs fall from the sky, I thought there were five legitimate UFO crashes, the things that were fairly well documented. You know, I was thinking of Roswell specifically, of course. I was thinking of Las Vegas in 1962. I was thinking of Kecksburg in 65. I was thinking of Shag Harbor. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking of the one that Jim Clarkson had been talking about in the Northwest. Since that book came out, I've pretty well revised that. You know, I'm very worried about some of them. You know, there's great documentation for Shag Harbor, for example, and the Canadians being involved, but nothing alien was recovered. Mm-hmm. Kecksburg is very problematic now to my way of thinking, especially with some of the information that's come out recently about it. I think Las Vegas is the same way. I think Las Vegas is a combination of two events that were timed very close together. They were some 15, 16 minutes apart and made it look like there was a big, long event, but there's really two separate events. You know, Roswell, if you want to look at it dispassionately, and that's what I did when I wrote Roswell in the 21st century. I wanted to look at the all the evidence dispassionately, but as it's a cold case, it's something that here is all this information. Let's see where we can take it. And when you get down to it, we have very few documents. We have an FBI telex, for example. We have the Ramey memo, which is the document General Ramey is holding in his hand, which mm-hmm. you know, when we start talking about provenance, here's a document with the perfect provenance. The guy's holding it in his hand. Mm-hmm. We know when the picture was taken. We know who took the picture. There's documentation showing that the picture was taken on July 8th, 1947. And we have General Ramey holding the document in his hand. We couldn't ask for a better provenance. We just can't read it.
Do you think there'll ever be, just to stop on that particular thought, do you think that technology will ever evolve enough to have that thing read? Or do you think that's just out of the question?
There is a consensus among those who deal with this sort of thing that the technology may improve to the point where we can read it. And there's some interesting stuff being done in the attempts to read it. I know David Rudiak thinks he has deciphered the thing pretty much intact. Mm-hmm. There are others who do not agree with all of his analysis. And what we need to do is come to a consensus or come to a place where another great example, the Roswell slides, where they had the placard and they said it couldn't be read. Well, you know, 2 days after the a high quality scan, high resolution scan was available to researchers, the placard was read. It was decoded. We could read it. We knew exactly what it said. And it was just that the technology was applied and we were able to read it. So as our technology evolves, we may be able to read it, but we need to have a consensus. And that was the thing with the Roswell slides. There was pushback on that when we said it could be read. But the consensus was, and we said, I shouldn't say we, the Roswell slides research group and those people said, well, here's how we did it. Here's how we decoded it. Here's the steps you need to go through and you'll get the same answer we did. We've got to get to the point where we have a consensus. And with the Ramey memo, even given the work that David Rudiak has done, the Herculean effort he has put into deciphering this thing, the problem we have is we have no consensus of exactly what it says. There are a number of places where we can actually read words. Like weather balloons, Fort Worth, Texas is spelled T-X-E for some reason. I don't know. It's not a proper abbreviation, and there may be something going on there that we don't understand. But for the most part, it's kind of there is no real consensus of what it says, and that's what we need. We need to have a consensus, and I can say to you, if you do this with your technology, you will read it. Well, you can find your own conclusions, and you'll probably see what we've seen. So with the Ramey memo right now, we're at the point where we're just on the fringe, and I think a couple of the people said if the camera had been a foot closer or Ramey had turned the document just slightly, we'd be able to read it perfectly. But, that's what we're living with that. So the answer is we may be able to get to a point where we have a consensus, although there will, like everything else in this field, there will be people who will disagree with us no matter what we offer in the way of proof.
Yes, yes. Hey, in the chat, we do have some questions in the chat room, and we actually have the Shag Harbor Incident Society interpretive is in the chat room right now. And you just mentioned Shag Harbor. I too agree that that's one of the one of the great cases out there. Actually going to be going up there to their convention, the 50th, this coming October, I think it is. I don't have anything here in front of me, but going to be broadcasting live from that.
Well, you realize you'd have to go to Canada to see it.
Oh, yes. No, I'll be out of Russia okay. by then. I hope I'll be out of Russia.
I was making fun of Canada.
Oh, there's going to be some feedback.
My show was hosted out of Hamilton, Ontario, Canada.
Oh, okay.
So we blame Canada for everything.
any technical difficulties, I'm sure that you blame that.
Yeah.
In the chat room early on, someone asked, they wanted to know what your thoughts were about Stan Friedman's stance on this particular document.
I think it's evolved, hasn't it? He originally was really excited about it and was pushing it. And then 2 days later, Friday, he was on Midnight in the Desert. By the way, I got bumped from it I because they were overbooked, which makes no sense to me. But on that program, he seemed to take a more neutral stance. I think that because I was ready to pounce on that because he's been a big advocate of Scott Ramsey's book and how well-researched it is. And this MJ-12 document is at odds with Ramsey's book. And so both of them can't be accurate and true. I suspect they're both false. But I was ready for that. But on the program, he seemed to have walked back from his initial excitement about it. And his initial excitement might have been simply he'd just seen the document and it looked good on a very cursory scan of it before mm-hmm. he got a chance to sit down and really read it. And that was one of the reasons, I was holding off as I wanted a chance to read the document through to see if there were any glaring errors, and there's more red flags flying than there are in communist China. So we pretty well figured it was a fake, but I think Stan's walked it back from now. I haven't heard anything from him since Friday. The other thing is it mentions Project Aquarius, and I know that Stan is really kind of ignored Project Aquarius. If you go back to Steinman's book, and there's another clue, there's the Aquarius document, which is supposedly the first MJ-12 document. But I think most everybody believes that Project Aquarius is that's faked, and it evolved from Project Aquarius into MJ-12. And so, that gives you kind of the evolution. But the point is, he mentioned Project Aquarius. When I queried him about that, he mentioned when I was doing my book, Case MJ-12, I had queried him about Project Aquarius. He said, I don't even mention it in my papers or in my book. And so I think he kind of ignored Project Aquarius, and now it's reared its ugly head again. So, but I think the answer is I'm not real sure what his opinion is at this point, but he seems to have walked it back from his initial enthusiasm.
Yes. Just an update. I've talked to people on this show in the past, and there's no update, actually. I'm in the fine arts and antiques business, and I was at an auction house where there was a retired CIA operative overseas who passed away several years ago. And in his footlocker, in his military footlocker, there were copies of the MJ-12 documents, but they were just the regular copies that have gone around and around. So nothing new at all.
Let me interrupt you here,
sure.
Because frankly, that's what I do, and it's your show, and I shouldn't do it. But not all that long ago, I got a call. A decade and a half ago, or something. I got a call from a guy who was attending a gun show. And he says, you got to get here right now. This guy's got some top secret documents about UFOs. So I rushed out to the gun show, paid my $2 to get in, and went over and looked at the MJ-12 documents.
Same ones.
You know,
same ones.
Yeah, the same ones we've all seen. I think they were partially redacted, as the ones that Bill Moore initially released were.
Yeah. My question was, why did this ex-CIA, retired CIA officer have them in the first place? But it could have, and I've never found out the answer to that. I was going to speak to his son, but he's not been available. So I don't think there's any answer. It's just maybe perhaps they were making the rounds because they thought they were humorous, or they had an interest in UFOs. There could be a lot of answers that really mean nothing.
Yes. And I've often, back when I was writing novels, we know that there's people who always read the last page of the book first.
Yes, that's me. I'm guilty.
So Bob Kern and I were writing a book about the special forces in Vietnam, and we inserted something at the end of the book that you would think an event would take place in the book at some point, which never does. But when you get to the end of the book, that sentence makes sense to you. So you're expecting something and it never happens because the way we had constructed it. The other thing we did, we had a glossary of the Vietnam terms in there, and we put in the glossary horse, and then we put Seabiscuit. Seabiscuit was a horse.
Right, a racehorse.
But it's S-E-E, biscuit, Seabiscuit. And then you go up to biscuit, and there was some nonsensical explanation for what it was, which wasn't used in Vietnam, but we just wanted to put that joke in the book. Horse, Seabiscuit, you know. And nobody ever catches these things.
Yeah.
The other thing, I go off on one more tangent for you. Bob and I were doing a book on the Alamo, and we were a time travel book. And one of the characters' name was Tom Waters. And so I wrote the line, Waters rushed uphill. And Bob says, you can't do that. And I said, nobody is ever going to pick it up because it's the name of the character. It flows naturally. Waters rushed uphill. And I suspect other writers do the same thing, you know, put these little nuggets in there that are amusing to them that the general public doesn't get. So,
well,
I have no idea what the relevance was, but there you go.
Well, if you're posting on social media today, if you write anything other than what's in the picture, people won't even notice it. They notice the picture. I think it's to the point that there's just so much information flying all over the place that people don't even take time to read anything.
They don't even take time to analyze it, because some of the things that you see are so diametrically opposed to the facts that you should say, well, this just can't possibly be true. And yet they accept it because they've read it somewhere, because you know you can't put anything on the internet that isn't true.
Hey, Kevin, I want to ask you off the bat, have you received like negative emails or people really upset that you're they're saying you're debunking this or anything like that?
On this particular thing, no. Uh-huh. I think practically everybody's in agreement. Steve Bassett, I had him on my show Saturday, and I thought we were going to have a very nice discussion about this document, where he would be advocating its legitimacy, and I would be suggesting, no, it's not true. And in the first 30 seconds, he says, well, you know, that document's a fake. And I'm going, oh, great, now what do I talk about? You know, we're on the same page here, pal. We don't get any have any kind of dialogue. And I mean, he was very excited about it when he called me on the Wednesday, but by the time we got to Saturday, he'd pretty well realized that the thing was faked. So I've gotten nothing like that. You know, I always try to hold the door on the defensive end of these things. I think we have to put up a great defense. If we're going to look at UFOs, we have to be able to defend our positions, for one thing. But we also have to point out the things that are false. And too often, people are looking for us to validate their own belief structure. And that just doesn't help us at all. Mm-hmm. Somebody really wants to believe in any of the mirrored subparts of UFO research, and you suggest that this case is maybe fraudulent or that case is bad or something, no matter what evidence you present, there are people who are going to be annoyed about it. I had done something with this General Lufkin, the lawyer from South Carolina, who was one of the people said he'd chatted with Eisenhower about the UFO crashes or something, and he became a big source. And I discovered that Lufkin was a general in what was called the State Guard Association, which is sort of a civilian organization that in some states it's looked on as a civilian auxiliary to the National Guard or things like that. It really has no real status, but he was a brigadier general in that, and they kept saying that. And I pointed out that, you know, this really isn't legitimate. In fact, I joined the organization, became a major general in it just to prove I could do it. And the I got a lot of blowback on that. People really annoyed about it. Hmm. But I'm thinking, you know, if we're going to understand the phenomenon, if we're going to understand what's going on, we have to look at all the stuff. And I can't tell you the number of people that have claimed to be military veterans who were not, or claiming a lot higher rank or position than they actually had. Great example gets back to MJ-12, the original document, the Eisenhower briefing document. There's this story paragraph on this crash on December 6, 1950, near El Indio Guerrero, in just across the border from Texas. And it's an outgrowth of a story told by this guy named Robert Willingham. And the story that we had is Willingham was a retired colonel from the United States Air Force. He'd been a fighter pilot. Nobody had ever bothered to check his military record until I did it, like, you know, 15 years ago. And it turned out that Willingham had been in the military for 13 months. He joined in December of 1945. Which makes him technically a veteran of World War II, because the war didn't technically end till 1946. So he's technically a veteran of World War II. He didn't never heard a shot fired in anger. He was in for 13 months. That's his military career. But he's telling everybody he was a fighter pilot and he was chasing these UFOs over Texas. First it was in 1948, then it was 1950, then it was the mid-1950s. And that sort of thing. And looking at that, the story he told, it isn't true. I mean, his military background is the 13 months. He was in the Civil Air Patrol, which is an Air Force auxiliary, civilians, and they perform a wonderful, wonderful service by taking the burden of search and rescue off the active duty forces. In other words, if you're a Civil Air Patrol member and you have an airplane and there's what they used to call a red cap, which is a legitimate search, you're called up and you're given a grid and you go out and search this grid flying your airplane. So, and the government will pay for your cost of your fuel and things like that. So you get to fly your airplane for free, which is, you know, a lot of people will say, well, that's a great deal. But you're not part of the Air Force. You're an auxiliary to the Air Force. You do not get retirement points for it. But Willingham tried to switch his Civil Air Patrol service into the Air Force Reserve and get a pension. In other words, he was trying to commit fraud, mm-hmm. which doesn't make him look very good. Mm. He said that he gotten out of the active duty Air Force because he'd been injured and they wouldn't let him fly fighters anymore, but they let him fly fighters in the Air Force Reserve. I had a number of friends when I was still in the National Guard, and I was assigned to our state headquarters. And of course, and I hesitate to use the term given the way it goes, but it was a purple headquarters, which means it had Red Army and Blue Air Force. So it was a combined headquarters. So I had a lot of friends who were fighter pilots. So I asked one of them about it. He said, no, that's not true. He said, the reason you would be disqualified from flying fighters is if the injuries had been such that the forces of ejection would injure you more, or you wouldn't be able to stand the forces of ejection. You could be transferred into flying transport airplanes or something else like that. So you continue flying in the Air Force. Your jobs would be limited. Mm-hmm. And you wouldn't move from the active service to the reserve because the same forces applied. Just something that he didn't know. But so that kind of calls into question the whole Eisenhower briefing document, because you have this paragraph about this event that Willingham invented in 1968. I found the original quotes, in fact, in the old Skylook, which was the MUFON Journal's original incarnation. So, this to me was like the fatal flaw in the mm-hmm. Eisenhower briefing document, takes the whole thing down.
Right.
But the point is, here's a guy who claimed military service at a high level. He when we checked the military records, it didn't hold up. There were pictures of him in Air Force uniform, so one from the 1960s, and people said, well, how could you have a picture of him in Air Force uniform as an Air Force officer if he wasn't in the Air Force? And I looked at the picture, and I said, it's a Civil Air Patrol uniform, pal. Uh-huh. And the giveaway was on the collar, you could see the CAP, and the Civil Air Patrol wears a metal badge over the right pocket that said Civil Air Patrol Air Force Auxiliary or something like that, U.S. Air Force Auxiliary. And you could see it on the picture. So wow. It was an Air Force uniform, yes, but it was Civil Air Patrol. And then in the other pictures, he's got on the Civil Air Patrol ribbons. In the Civil Air Patrol, you can wear ribbons you earned in the military. In other words, all the ribbons I earned as an Army officer, I could wear on my Civil Air Patrol uniform, and they would take precedent above any ribbons I earned in the Civil Air Patrol. And in his uniform, in the pictures that I've seen, he's got both the Civil Air Patrol ribbons and some ribbons I don't think he earned. Ribbons from the Air Force. So, it's clearly a Civil Air Patrol uniform as opposed to an Air Force uniform. So, I mean, but a lot of people would look at that and they didn't pick up on that. They saw him in the khaki uniform from the mid-1960s, what was called the 505 uniform. And they say, well, here's an Air Force uniform in the mid-1960s. How do you explain that? And the answer is, it's not an Air Force uniform, pal. It's Civil Air Patrol.
Yeah. Well, back in, I think about 2 or 3 years ago, I had Bill Burns was on the show, and we were talking about the Mexico crash, collision when the small airplane, collides supposedly with a UFO.
Yes.
And the military got involved. Well, that was 1974. And I had someone was listening live at the time wrote me during the show in the chat room and said that they were actually one of the military people on the U.S. that was there on site. Well, I looked into the guy's record as much as I could. And, yes, it did show that he was in – I think he was in perhaps the Army or something like that. And this was all through social media that I was looking. And then I saw his birth date, 1965. So I wrote him, nice try. You can't be 9 years old and be doing that. So I'm sure just with my short experience, there must be a lot of people that are, trying to get some type of glory out of certain, situations like you just mentioned.
Well, there's something called stolen valor, which is people wearing military awards and decorations they did not earn, wearing military uniforms that they are not authorized to wear, and things like that. Mm-hmm. And you can check those. I was reading an obituary from a guy in the paper, and it said he was a Vietnam veteran. And I looked at his birth date, and he was born in 1957. And I'm thinking, mm-hmm. no, You were not a Vietnam veteran. Our forces were pretty much out of Vietnam by 72, but we did have some specialized forces, and I'd say specialized as opposed to special forces, in Vietnam till April of 1975. But none of those people would have been 18 years old.
Yeah, you'd have to be born in 1955 or before to be in Vietnam.
Pretty much. And so it just all little things like that. And I'm thinking, you know, do I write the newspaper and say, well, this guy's a lying sack of, but the guy's dead, you know, and his family's not going to be happy with that.
Yeah.
So the other thing is I was reading the paper and it said, talked about this guy from, this poor soul who had been on the Titanic, managed to survive that, and had been on the Lusitania. And it gave all these details. And I finally wrote to, and I've got a book here that lists all the survivors off the Titanic. And his name was not among them.
Wow.
So, and now in today's world, you could go on the internet and you can type in, you know, Titanic survivors and get the whole list of names. But he wasn't among it. So this guy had been running around in the 1930s claiming that. Or the other one that I always cite is at one point at the turn of the century, and by that I mean the last century, from 1899 to 1900, there were carnivals all over the country. And 15 guys claiming to be the real Jesse James. Hmm. Well, you know, 14 of them had to be lying.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, it's a little bit, you know, bringing the UFO topic back into it. It's a little bit like like Rendlesham Forest. You know, there's questions, you know, going back and forth about Larry Warren, whether he was actually there when he actually there's, you know, I don't know. We don't have to get into that at all. But I mean, supposedly there's a letter written to his mother that says he's talking about his roommate that was actually there, you know. So I know there's controversy, and I know when something major like that happens, there's a lot of people that want to, you know, when they know enough information about it, they want to get some of the glory from it. I guess that's what it all boils down to.
There's absolutely no question that Larry Warren was serving at the base there in December of 1980. I have seen videotape. Russ Estes had interviewed Warren at length, and Warren was saying when the event took place, he was on leave in Germany. Charles Halt said no, when the third night took place, Warren was actually drunk in the barracks and was not a part of the activities there. But Warren was there and heard his colleagues. Warren had been in the Air Force for, what, 8 months or something like that when he was assigned there, so he didn't have a very lengthy military career. There's no question he was assigned to the base. The real question is, did he participate in the events, or did he just hear his colleagues talking about it? I suspect he just heard his colleagues talk about it. I know Halt is just livid with Larry Warren, and I think over the top livid on that. But I mean, there's another example. The guy was at least there. He may not have been a participant in the events, but he was at least there. You know, and I say that sometimes about people in Vietnam who claim they were in Vietnam. At least they were there, even though they were in a fairly safe. Pat Sajak from Wheel of Fortune was in Vietnam. I spent the longest time when we would go out to pre-flight the aircraft before the missions. You know, the automatic direction finder covers the broadcast radio band, so we could listen to the radio. And so we would listen to the radio as we were checking in with operations and all that, and we'd hear Pat Sajak. You know, he was Army PFC Pat Sajak. I always thought it was a tape that they had flown over from the States for him, but actually, I guess he was in Saigon doing his radio show.
Like, so there's a guy, Robin Williams, Good Morning Vietnam. Right.
Well, Robin Williams wasn't in there.
I know. I'm just saying, like the movie, he was the radio announcer.
Yes, and they were in Saigon doing the Armed Forces Radio, AFVN. And here's one more war story. And I don't mean to do this, but we would always listen to the radio while we're flying the missions. You know, you got the ADF going in the background, listen, like when you're driving your car. Had all the other radios going too, and if there was a good song on the radio, somebody would just key the mic and say ADF, which means you needed to turn on your ADF if you weren't listening to it so you could hear the good tune. So we're going into a high old Z. We're taking fire. And in the middle of all this shooting, somebody says ADF. And what it was Arthur Brown, the crazy world of Arthur Brown, and he was singing Fire.
Good timing. Wow.
So, yeah, that's what I thought. So anyway, but I digress, and I don't mean to. The point simply is, I think, you know, too often people do not check the backgrounds of those claiming military service. And we end up with these guys making claims about high-ranking officers saying this, that, or the other thing. And it turns out that they weren't in a position to know. They did not hold the positions they claimed, and they didn't hold the ranks they claimed. And that kind of undercuts any credibility they would have.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Back to the document. Who do you think would – I mean, someone obviously spent hours and hours and hours of time putting this together. Do you think it had any type of link with the original, you know, MJ-12 documents, or do you think this is someone that did this recently on their own?
I think there's somebody did it recently on their own. It's not disinformation. And there's another interesting thing. When I was talking to Steve Bassett about it, the first time he said, well, you know, there's three or four different things. It's disinformation. It's somebody put it together themselves or something like that. When we talked, when he and I talked on Saturday, he was of the opinion it was not disinformation. It was just somebody had put it together. I agree with that. I had come to that assessment as well, that somebody just put it together. It's a recent document put together for the amusement of whoever did it. I don't know if he or she thought they could float this into the UFO community and then a week or two later say, ha-ha, gotcha, you dumbasses. You couldn't tell the fakes from the real. And the consensus seems to be it's faked. Or somebody looking to kind of promote the 70th anniversary of the Roswell case by throwing this out. But I think it came from the civilian world, if you will. Somebody put it together, had a limited knowledge of the UFO materials, had a limited knowledge of how classifications work, and had, I would bet money on it, used as a template for some of this information, UFO crash at Aztec.
Yes.
By William Steinman.
Okay. So just to let the live listener know, in the chat room, I have not forgotten you, and I will get to your questions, and feel free to keep posting them on there. So this document, I think I wrote you in an email the other day that when it comes to the conversation, the interview with the EBE that supposedly survived from the Aztec crash, it did the lingo. You mentioned the English that was used and all that, and yes, I agree. Also, the content of what the EBE was supposedly saying, it just didn't make sense to me that that's how – and I don't even know how an extraterrestrial would talk. You know, would they come down to our level to try to speak to us in a way that we'd understand and all that? So I have no idea, but – do you think there was any creativity in that part at all, or do you think it was just kind of like how I feel? I just feel like an ET wouldn't say those type of things.
Well, apropos of nothing at all, I noticed that Klaatu talked to us pretty much as an intelligent individual. Yes, Klaatu was the Michael Rennie character in The Day the Earth Stood Still. Klaatu Barada Nikto for all of you people out there. No, it was just stupid. I don't. You've got supposedly multiple interviewers talking to this alien creature, however they're communicating it, and they're not saying, "Well, where's your home world? Mm-hmm. What star do you come from?" No, we're saying, "Well, we came here because we like the trees."
Yeah,
and I'm up for trees. I mean, trees are cool. I like trees. I'm not sure I'm going to be flying to other planets and other solar systems to see their trees unless they're really exotic. But I mean, no, it just didn't make any sense at all.
What about the children part of it too, right?
Well, we always must think of the children.
Yeah.
I remember the Simpsons episode where they're doing that, and they're like, "What about the children?" And the guy jumps out the window because the children are going to be somehow hurt. And I mean, it's just it doesn't make any sense. It's just absolutely ludicrous. it's sort of put together as a stream of consciousness as opposed to something with a lot of thought put into it. You know, if I'm interviewing an alien creature, I'm wanting to know where they're coming from. I'm wanting to know their mission. I'm wanting to know how they defeat the distances, the interstellar distances. Mm-hmm. I'm wanting to know what source of energy they use. All of these things are very difficult to invent, mm-hmm. to make up. Mm-hmm. For this, although I think I'd say they came from the Tau Ceti system, but I don't know why. It's a kind of a cool star. Oh, Aldebaran is cool. You know, something like that. But it's just stuff that's really easy to make up. It doesn't take any thought, I guess, is what I'm trying to say. And so the interview was, if I had been creating the document. And I'd run it by a pal, he'd have probably said, lose the interview, because that really sends up a red flare. Let's say a red flare on a hot air balloon, on a weather balloon, a red flare on a weather balloon for people to see. It's just absolutely ludicrous.
Did you watch the movie Arrival that came out last year?
I did.
And they asked the questions that you would want to ask, I think. And I'm surprised they didn't kind of use that as a little bit of a template.
I think the person that did this wasn't smart enough to go see that movie.
Well, that's it for the free part of the show. Thanks so much for listening. And we'll be back next week with Philip Mantle talking about UFO incidents in the UK and so much more. And if you want to watch that live on YouTube, it'll be 1 to 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time next Wednesday. Thanks so much again, and remember you can support the show for only $2 or more per month. And remember to keep your eyes to the sky. See you next week.